it's on. What is really important? Just for a quick aside, last November 9th was the date of the fall of the Berlin Wall. Huge deal in history. Huge deal. And in the Second World War, Berlin Wall falls, communism finito. Not one television station mentioned that of 1900 New York City. But what did they mention? What was dominating the news?
Uh-oh.
Day after day after day. Very trivial matter compared to something like the Berlin Wall. So why bother to mention this? Because it has affected the psyche of the audience. It's affected the psyche of everyone. Our mind fills us up with trivia instead of leaving us a kind of a spiritual room we can walk in or to dream in. What's a dream? A dream is a movie. Everyone has a little movie projector in their skull. And something can happen that will all of a sudden push a button and you can run a movie in your skull, which is called simply imagination. Imagination is an image that you can go dig. And people call that imagination is not a strong enough word. It's not that, I'm sure you can find a substitute for it.
Well, you're talking about movies, and movies involve lenses. Have you ever used a camera obscura or a camera lucida?
Did you hear the question?
No, I've never used a camera obscura, but never needed to. People make a big deal out of it. I just like Vermeer. I thought cameras themselves and photography has played a very significant role in my work. But painting from a photograph as such smells, painting when it's done smells like a photograph. It's something that doesn't, that kind of painting doesn't interest me, the photographic realism. Someone has a question.
Can you repeat the question for the recording?
Oh, the question was, you brought us composition, and how did you pose the figures?
No, not pose them, but your compositions are incredible. And what I learned from you when I was young is composition.
Oh, thanks. I'm glad. You're a very good artist. You were already a great artist before you came to me. You had
no, I was not. But what I was how to put things together. And I think that if you took two paintings and explained how you put them together, that would really help a lot of my students who are in the audience.
Oh, great.
All right, I'll be happy to.
Repeat the question.
There's one more hand up. About the paintings, yes. I guess Jack was going to ask that question.
Well,
we gave a chance, I'm sorry.
Well, I was going to actually say that you talked about the artists that influenced you, but you haven't mentioned Bellini yet.
Oh, my pictures. No, these pictures.
And that kind of brings us to
these pictures. Movies, yeah, play a huge role in influencing my vision. Especially filmmakers like Kurosawa, Fellini, and others that are loved by all of you. The spirit of the films of Fellini influenced me very much. And the subject matter of these paintings came right after I finished the circus mural that is now in Sarasota, down in Sarasota. After I finished the circus, I'll take a look at the compositions. These all, obviously, no one posed for these pictures. They're all made up. The compositions, i.e., are made up. The individual elements are based on real things, and sometimes even they are made up. To work out the composition, the reason for these drawings
is to tell me what it is, what can the picture possibly look like. As you can see, there's a difference between the drawing of Sloth with the man on the Galapagos turtle, which happens to be a self-portrait, by the way. I took my picture myself in the chair. I have some costumes in my studio with that curly wig on, and made myself be the model because I'm handy. I don't have to hire someone. I'm going to definitely come over to the studio. The monkeys came from a book published by the Yerkes Primate Institute and others that I found in the library. And I would play just for the anatomy of the monkey, and then I could play with the faces by changing the mouths or what have you. So that none of these are actually based on real things. These two faces, one on the right is a man who collects minerals, by the way. The one on the left is my studio assistant. And I had faces in different spots, but sometimes to get the composition right, you do a beautiful head, a nicely drawn face, but it's the wrong place, compositionally. So you have to wipe it out and redraw it. I got sick of that, so I started cutting them out, back there. And so I could shift them around, put them in the proper place so I could adjust the compositions by actually shifting the drawings around. And this painting, thank you. Here's a picture that underwent a huge change. It started with the drawing over there with the wing and the dancers saying, well, it's ended. This figure. Envy, by the way, according to St. Thomas Aquinas, is a feeling of sadness that you somehow are suffering because of another person's gifts or abilities. So I had this sad looking figure from a photograph. I took a picture of her. And the dog is from a picture of a dog in a dog book. And the monkey is from Yerkes Primate book. And she was envious of flight. She's earthbound, and she envies flight. I started with the drawing of people having possessions, so you have a whole bunch of Mercedes and cars and people. It became too materialistic and too obvious. The problem with painting Seventh-day Descent is simply that if they're too obvious, they're sophomoric, and if they're too esoteric, no one will understand what the hell you're doing. So that's why it took me 20 years to do these pictures. And I meant to finish them all for the year 2000.
The human condition at the end of the 20th century.
I said to myself, that is baloney. Cut it out. It's pretentious. Do something in the tradition of Fellini, Chaplin, and introduce the comedic vein into it. But you can paint them in a serious way. Paint them like Caravaggio would do it, or old masters with no paint handling, obviously. None of my favorite painters like Sargent, but do it in an old master way, just for the fun of it, to amuse myself. And I knew it would be hard, and I want to do something that's harder than I knew music could do. I got very comfortable with mentioning landscape paintings. They're too easy. It was too easy for me, and I wanted to do something more challenging. I wanted to, like painting a mural, I wanted to break out of my comfort zone and try something. Just want to do the same damn picture over and over and over and over and over and get ad nauseum the way so many artists do. They get branded. This is my brand, I can stick to it. It happens to actors. I didn't want to get typecast as a painter of landscapes or painting a certain way. I want to branch out and do something I wasn't sure I could do. It's more engaging. And when you succeed, you have this personal feeling of elation. I would say a heightened sense of being. You feel, out of that. It's like breaking your frame of reference. And when I taught little kids, there would be children who could draw a really good horse. They'd draw the same horse over and over and over again. Side view horse. And and a guy named Victor Lowenfeld, who taught artist education, a book called Artist Education, that I was fascinated by when I was young. Still at AU, as a matter of fact. Sarah Baker introduced me to that book. And Lowenfeld talked about the frame of reference and how it's a security thing, because kids like it. You're such a good drawing, you draw this horse, well, I've lost the horse, draw a horse for it. So the child would keep drawing the same horse over and over and over. My challenge as a teacher was to make them draw a different horse. I thought, what else do horses do? Do they jump? Yes. Well, why don't you try a jumping horse? Do they eat? Yes. Well, how about a horse walking away? How about a horse coming forward? How about horses fighting? How about lions? How about tigers? How about the whole animal kingdom? So they branch out from that frame of reference and start painting the same, drawing the same thing over and over and over again. That should have been taught to Bernard Buffet, the French painter who was so stylish, with all these black lines, and all these stupid clowns, and all these tree branches, and a little color washed in over and over and over and over. And he painted himself out of favor the way this happens a lot. It happened in the Renaissance with Perugino. Pietro Perugino. He's painting the National Gallery of the three crosses. And the figure standing beside the crosses are the same figure. He had a template. He would trace that figure. The drapery is exactly the same. The poses are the same. It became a formula that he was eventually criticized for by some monks. I've read about it. They said, all his figures look like twins. So we're not going to commission him anymore.
Would you consider doing anything with computer art?
I was dragged into the computer world, kicking and screaming, while I was teaching at GW. All of a sudden, I came to office one day, and there's a big computer at my desk. I can't even type. So I had a little prejudice there before I had to learn how to use this machine. Here's what happened. It all goes back to two things. The invention of the wheel. Things started going down with the invention of the wheel. And the internal combustion engine. I sound like a Luddite, but I'm really not. The electricity is an artificial source of power. What are you going to do when the power grid goes out? You can't use a computer. I had a friend who bought an ocean racing yacht. And he had all this electronic gear on it. And it worked great with, like, course computers and this and that. He gets out, as soon as you get outside of land, everything broke down. So you have to learn how to navigate on your own. You need to, I put too much emphasis on this, but the problem with electricity is it destroyed, neon signs, destroyed sign paper. My grandfather said, these metric signs are going to put the old sign painter out of business. And they did. There are no sign painters anymore. Hmm. My grandfather was an inspiration to me as a boy because he would draw a line on a pencil on a piece of sheet metal that they nailed to frames. There was a wood shop in the studio, and I used to watch him paint every day, every single day. I come home from school, watch my grandfather paint, and I was lucky. Well, go back to this electric stuff. His hand was like a machine. He would draw a line from the top, a line from the bottom, and the letters in between with a quill brush, a very, very soft brush, it's chisel point. And it was like watching a machine. The curves were perfect, O's were great. W's, thick and thin letters. You can do spin serious script. You paint a Coca-Cola size. And I grew up in that environment with my dad and my granddad. And not only did they take the National Gallery, but they gave me brushes and paints and things I painted with them. They did the carpentry to build the signs. I'd come home from school and my teacher said, would I paint a sign for the football game or something? And I said, Grandpa, would you mind painting because your letters are much better than mine? And he would begrudgingly often help me out like that, doing props in school play and so forth. So I had wonderful, wonderful support from a family that was very affectionate and encouraging. And I was very lucky because we didn't have television until I was 14.
So there was no electricity, electric entertainment in the house. We used to love to go to the movies. And my dad would take me to see Bogart and John Wayne, and President of Sierra Madre, a great movie I'll never forget. And then we were reading Hemingway, Dispose of Kilimanjaro. When I grew up, I said, I want to have adventures. I want to go to Kilimanjaro. I want to go to South America. I want to go to China. And that spirit of adventure has stayed with me. And
you're leading right into the question I was going to ask a little farther down the pipe, but I feel like I need to ask you now about narrative. All of your famous murals, you know, your narrative art obviously came from this exposure to traveling all over the world, looking all over the world, painting inside other painters all over the world. But you are most known probably for the historic murals, the circus mural, but the one mural I wanted you to start with, because I think it's the most fun story, is the Clyde's murals. Back to flesh.
Yes, what about Clyde's murals? I don't know if you know about them, but Ben Porgy was very complimentary. Ben Porgy, I've seen in the audience. Critic for the Washington. Great, wonderful, intelligent guy. Thanks, Ben, for coming. It's great to see you. So happy you're here. Billy. Well, the Clyde's murals, well, first of all, a word about murals. Murals differ from easel painting in many fundamental ways. First of all, they're designed for an ambulatory spectator instead of a stationary one. You walk by the mural and look at it. Second, they are an adventure and satisfy a look for adventure. The art is an adventure because you break out of this frame of reference of doing the same kind of painting over and over and over again that you're comfortable with and have a challenge. Uh-oh, I wonder if I can do this. It's one, size is daunting. Two, I'm not familiar with the subject matter. I've not painted 45 frolicking nudes and landscapes before. But what fun that would be. And as you get into it, you become, as you step out of your frame of reference to a traditional way of painting, written in landscapes and that sort of thing, beach scenes, cafes, which I still love and admire and look at. But to do these figures was a test. I was able to test myself. And to listen to the person, the people who commissioned the work, sometimes they have better ideas than you do. Often artists say, oh gee, I've got a commission, the client says, blah, 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 blah. In most, historically, the person, the painter, has a great idea. Sistine Chapel, for example, great idea by a painter. Said, Michelangelo, here's my idea, can you do this, this, and that? And he had an adventure, he rose to the challenge. The scale is also the physicality of it all, which is, you talked about the sensual nature of the painting material. Take a big, big brush on a large canvas, boom, like this, huh? And then the hard part, of course, is you have to clean out the brush. So the symptoms can be handy, but they're scarce. And sometimes you can be too busy keeping him busy so that you can work yourself. So it's better off sometimes, I think, better off to work alone than in company.
So we need to open it up for questions in a minute. So could you just wrap up and tell us a little about how you came to paint? That was your first major.
Clyde's was my first big commission. Yeah, it was 50.
How you got it? Okay,
75 feet by something.
72 feet.
And I hired some girls like that. We called girls back then. Young women. Miss Pennsylvania was extraordinary, beautiful woman. And very, very frisky and fun. And she had girlfriends. And they said, let's pose for Billy's mural. So I got a big piece of black mosaic paper. I rented some spotlights. I had two guys with cameras. And I said, okay, next man, hold hands. Front view, side view, back view, da da da. Click, 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 click. Took dozens and dozens of black and white photographs. And then made made drawings, assembled them together, and invented the compositions. And so the figures need to interlock, they need to overlap, which actually saved the murals. Because last year, they tore down a class, and were going to cut the murals up in small pieces and try to sell fragments. But they couldn't, because if you cut one figure, you wound up with the arm of another one intruding into the composition. So you couldn't extrapolate a figure from the composition because they're all interlocked. Anyway, Ben Forney wrote an article about the paintings. He said, is it a restaurant, is it an art gallery, or both? And then I can't paraphrase you, that was about 30, 40 years ago. They were inspired by the paintings by Howard Chandler Christie at the Café des Artistes up in New York. They're still there. The Café des Artistes is now called, what's it called, remember?
Leopard
des Artistes. The Leopard Des Artistes. Well, I went for lunch. I tried to get in. I was in Europe last week. Take a look at them. Howard Chandler Christie didn't do compositions. He did vignettes. He did a lot of foliage and little girls kicking out of the bushes and things. But they weren't unified compositions. So you could compose the murals, kept them from being destroyed. They couldn't cut them up. And they have been subsequently rescued and cleaned. The adventure part is really, I cannot emphasize enough, the excitement and the feeling of being alive when you are living through this kind of adventure of creating something you yourself have never seen before, and neither has anybody else. To do something, that's a big challenge, to do something no one's ever seen before, including you.
So we should open it up to the audience a little bit and have them ask some questions before we hit the line. So is there anybody who would like to ask a question? Don't be bashful.
Ben has a question.
Well, an observation first. It's been a lot of fun. All these years, long ago, sounds like too long ago. It's still fresh in your mind, isn't it?
Oh, yes.
Anyway, my question is, your worst work seems so aleatory, and yet it is involved and carefully planned. You talk about composition, and you talk about surface, and paint movement, and movement of figures. How does that work out in your mind? I mean, are you conscious of it, or by now has it become second nature? But the combination of imagination, improvisation, and preconception.
Well, there's a tremendous amount of editing. Even not just in these murals and complex compositions involving overlapping figures. The editing process happens preferably in drawing, because they're easy to trash or modify and start another version. For example, I did two versions of that sort of thing. I just distracted myself. Ask the question one more time.
I'm just talking about, just looking at your works, there's a big combination of things, and I wonder how they come together. Preconception, planning, imagination, and then in the execution, this wonderful bravura, which seems like improvisation.
I restrained the bravura in these pictures. I tried to make them more controlled and more old masterish and more traditional looking. That was a conscious decision based on, not an original idea of mine, but I read that Thomas Mann, when he wrote The Confessions of Felix Krull, the Confidence Man, said he wanted to combine the aristocratic milieu with the criminal milieu in a comedic way. And I said, these could be painted seriously, but be entertaining and slightly wry and amusing simultaneously. That happened initially. The pictures fluctuated back and forth. The conscious decision to make the change from that ballerina to this particular painting, which is not the darkest of all the pictures, not very funny, was partly inspired by the poem of William Blake, The Sick Rose. And I quoted it in the catalog when Jack and I were talking about it. Years ago I read it, and I never forgot it. And it goes like this. O rose thou art sick, the invisible worm that flies in the night in the howling storm has found out that bed of crimson joy, and his dark secret love doth thy life destroy. The worm is envious of the rose. The worm is earthbound. The worm is envious of life, the bird. And if I make it a little worm, make the worm morph into a dragon. And the sick rose is implied by the things at the bottom, the details in the margins of the painting. That was the way I could express anything, because the sick rose, the worm that flies in the night has found out by the bed of crimson joy, his dark secret love doth that night destroy. It's like cancer, seeing something beautiful and wonderful, and wants it hates it, destroys it. It's a kind of ending. The dog with the bone, he doesn't want it, no one else can have it either. There's an anger involved in envy and a feeling of sadness. So these things were conscious decisions. The exciting part, once you make the decision, then you've got to materialize it. You've got to give it form. And that is what's so engaging. It's not fun. It's enjoyable, but it's really engaging and very frustrating. So that's why it took me 20 years, because I didn't like it. I had painted, actually painted the wing. In the wing there was actually painted there. That's under all this. Dancing figures under. There are other figures in this painting too. And I took them out. It's my picture, man, and I can do whatever I want with it. If I want to paint it out, paint it out.
And he is. Bravo Gracchi used to say in his classes that I was in, this Woodward, he could paint all the paper faster than anybody I've ever seen. There was paint all over him and all over the room, but he finished his painting like that, and it was perfect. Did you comment on that?
Well, I didn't. That's fun. That's a lot of fun. I still enjoy that kind of work. Ben Forgy once said, in a group show I was in, and my friend Frank Wright, who unfortunately is not here, that wonderful artist, Frank said, you gotta stay in Washington, people run off around the world having adventures, other people are gonna forget about you. I'm having a show, there's gonna be a show. And so I called my wife back in the States, and I said, take one of those pictures in the gallery. It's the gallery on B Street. And Ben said, didn't mention Frank was in the show too, didn't mention Frank. He said, I was overseas. And I laughed at him. And William Woodward retains the title as the fastest Russian piece. As the fastest explosive, fastest gun in the West. And this reverb, this excitement of paint handling and the way paint behaves, is a beautiful show of abstract paintings, but right over there, by three women. The joy of paint manipulation has its own satisfaction. It brings tremendous satisfaction to the way paint behaves. And the lady over there, what's her name, Jack?
Anne
Marchand. Boy, you can see the joy of the way, just watching paint behave the way it does. That is valuable for its own sake. As far as it goes, it's worthwhile, valuable for its own sake. The way paint behaves and the sensuous nature of it. Look at de Kooning. De Kooning was very exciting painting, okay? And the violence of it, and so art, to me, does all these wonderful things. It can be soft and tender, and it can be brutal and robust. If you look at Rembrandt's painting, you'll see moments of extreme tenderness and great delicacy, and come to the same painting with brutal brushstrokes.
that took a second. So this is a combination of strength and sensitivity, I think, that makes art so important, beautiful to us. The way I talked about those Egyptian monuments, those giant monumental poodle-looking pharaohs, if you look at the hieroglyphs, each little grasshopper, each little bird, has got a tremendous sensitivity. It's not brutal, it's not domination, it's a tremendous delicacy to it.
Are there any other questions? I do want to let Bill sign some catalogs here, and want him to be able to have a glass of champagne.
I want to thank all of you for coming. I'm very touched. It means a lot.
I just want to handle on this. Bill's love of life, his reverence for the past, but his joie de vivre as he continues to grow and experiment and do things. That's why this old man appears so young.
Thanks.